Good morning, members. Today we have one bill before us, House File 181. Members, I'd like to bring House File 181 before the committee and move that it be re-referred to GovOps. The intention is, if you look through your packet, there's a few amendments. One of them includes a provision that Chair Sanders had said he'd like to hear in GovOps committee. I think, if I'm not mistaken, it's the A1. Assumption would be, if that amendment goes on, Chair Sanders has said he would like to hear the bill. Members, I think we'll probably, it'll take a little while for Director Johnson and Assistant Director Coop to walk through the bill. So we'll let them walk through the bill and have questions from members. Remember, this is the bill that deals with the dedicated sales tax. This is the one-third of the three-eighths of dedicated sales tax that goes to Habitat. And so welcome, Director Johnson, Assistant Director Coop. If you could identify yourself for the record and begin your presentation. Thank you.
For the record, I'm Mark Johnson, Executive Director for the Minnesota... almost got that wrong. Executive Director for the Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage Council.
I'm Heather Coop, Assistant Director for the Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage Council.
Welcome, and begin.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members. Thank you for having us here this morning. I'd like to bring to the council the regrets of our chairman for the council, David Hartwell. He was unable to make it today, otherwise he definitely wanted to be here. In front of you, before we go into the wording of the bill, we have a couple of handouts. One is a two-page handout with both sides that we'll go through first. It's a summary overview of the bill, and also we'll be mentioning this map that is along with your handouts as well. That's a map showing the distribution of potential projects across the state that would be from this appropriation. As an overview, in the handout, the tables and figures that are summarized are basically the what, where, and the who of the expected impacts of the appropriations regarded in this bill. This is the seventh year, and this appropriation package entails recommendations for 35 proposals for $100 million approximately. The data does not include impacts anticipated from the Conservation Partners Legacy Grants Program, which entails about $8.4 million of appropriation, and that's the specific appropriation on page 14 through 16, I think it's 5H. The what of this is the majority of the activity, basically 77% of the recommendations is in enhancement and restoration that incurs no PILT liability. The majority of funding, about 75%, is for acquisition, and that's broken down into 54% for fee acquisition and 21% for easement acquisition. PILT obligations from the fee acquisition are estimated at $174,180. The anticipation is there will be 50 full-time equivalent employments from this as a result of this funding with appropriations. That breaks down into 32 FTEs to state government, 17 to NGOs, and one to local unit of government. Outputs and outcomes are different. Outputs are basically the acreages and those very definable things. Outcomes are a bit more what we'd really like to see in the end, but those outcomes are improved water indicators, remnant prairies and wetlands, remnant native prairies and wetlands, perpetually protected protection enhancement and restoration of habitat for migratory waterfowl, upland birds, and species of greatest concern, and et cetera. I won't read them all for you, but they're all listed there. The who, as we go into the second page of the handout, gives you an idea of the organizations that are receiving. There are seven local government organizations. There's one tribal, two state agencies, and 10 non-government organizations that are proposed for receiving funds through this. The continued investment on robust ongoing programs constitutes 66% of the recommendations, including, for example, the Cannon River Watershed Habitat Complex. That's phase five. the Wild Rice Shoreline Protection Phase 4, and the Minnesota Trout Unlimited Cold Water Fish Habitat Protection or Enhancement Phase 8, I'm sorry, Phase 7. 14% of the recommended programs involve two or more entities working in partnership to leverage their resources, and the public and private conservation partnerships include 24 are involved in 24 programs here, with over $20 million in leverage in play. There's a chart on the at the top of page 2 that is basically broken down into the biological distinctions of the state, be it the wetlands, prairies, forests, habitats, sections of the state. You can see the acreages is this first one. It breaks down into restore versus protect in easement and enhance. The protect is broken out also with pilt and non-pilt, so you can see the acreages and the percentages. Below that is the activities, area of activities in a pie chart for you, and funding of activities in pie chart. And you can look at those at your leisure. And then at the very bottom is it's broken out into the funding, how the funding breaks into restore versus protect in fee with pilt or without pilt, protect in easement or enhance. Hopefully those will be useful to you. Page 3 of the handout comes with the where these dollars are going to go. The majority of activity, 76% and 69% of the funding, are recommended to be focusing on the prairie and prairie transition areas of the state, supporting the goals of the and objectives of the Minnesota Prairie Plan. 1,865 acres of native prairie is anticipated to be acquired. 2,143 acres of native prairie will be restored and enhanced through these recommendations. The forests in the northern and southeastern regions of the state are anticipated to see 20% of the activity. 26% of the recommended funding is dedicated to this activity. 3% of the activity is for the metro and urbanized area. That includes 5% of the funding, but we should note that the Conservation Legacy Partner Program is not included. That is entails about $3.692 million in grants for the 7 county metro area or cities with populations of 50,000 or greater. So that's over and above that 5% of funding and that 3% of activity we're talking about. 162 miles of shoreline will be restored, enhanced, or protected. And there are, again, a couple of more charts on this page 3 for your viewing, so you can see from an ecological section standpoint how the acreage and how the funding break out. Probably the takeaway from that is, again, the enhancement is a huge portion of the acreages in the ecological section this year. And on the very back side of the handout is a breakdown of, again, the appropriation, the individual projects within the appropriation as they're listed in the bill. The map that you have, as I mentioned, is merely a representation of the distribution of those projects across the state. There's a legend in the lower left-hand corner that gives you an idea what is protect in fee without pilt versus protect in enhancement, protect with pilt, etc., enhancement itself and restorations. And if you have any questions on those, I'd be happy to handle those. Otherwise, we'll move on to the bill.
Representative Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and thank you, Mr. Johnson. I have a question about the this is relatively new to me. I arrived late last time, so I didn't get in on these discussions, so I'm trying to learn here. The activity in the metro urbanizing area, is there much I see that cities of 50,000 or greater qualify. Is there much interest in the city by the cities outside the metro area in the in that funding?
Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair, Representative Johnson, the information we have right now from the DNR is there's been one year of appropriation with that, and the DNR has been quite happy with the results of the projects that have been coming in or the proposals for those monies. The they're happy with the quality and they're happy with the quantity, so it's reaching the full amounts of the monies.
Representative Johnson, maybe Director Johnson, should someone from DNR speak specifically, has Mankato, Rochester, or Duluth made an application, and has it been accepted? Is that information available to us? You know, and if it's not, let's get it within the next 15 minutes or so, so we know the answer to that. That deals with that CPL grant program, and it looks like they're conferring additional follow-up, and then Representative Johnson, we will get an answer. That's a good question.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chair. One follow-up. The definition of a city with a population of 50,000 or greater, the Mankato, North Mankato, those are two separate cities, and Mankato does not have 50,000, but I would want to make sure that the metropolitan, it's a designated metropolitan area, does qualify under the definition of 50,000 or greater.
Okay.
That's what I need.
Thank you, Representative Johnson, and it does look like they went out to find the answer to those questions, so, and we'll get it before we start to have a discussion on or move any amendments, for instance. Representative Clark.
Thank you. Mr. Johnson, I was trying to understand when you were talking about the metro area, and I see on the handout 3% of the activity is constitute 5% of funding recommended, 5% of the funding that is recommended in this bill, or 5% of the funding that's recommended for that area?
Director Johnson or Assistant Director Hoop, did you understand the question?
Representative McNamara, Representative Clark.
Thank you.
The 5% figure is from the total appropriation, but it does not include the roughly $4 million that's earmarked for projects in the metropolitan area. So once those have been dispersed and we understand where they were going in terms of protect, restore, enhance, those numbers will change.
Additional follow-up. Representative Clark.
Yeah, I'm trying to understand. Why is it not included? I mean, I didn't, when you were presenting it, why don't you just say this is the percentage instead of saying it's not in there, but it will be? Confusing to follow. I'm not as familiar with this probably as I need to be yet.
Representative Director McNamara, Representative Clark, you're right, it is confusing. But when we sit down and do the analysis and trying to determine how much money is spent in the three constitutional activities, we can only go by what is included in those accomplishment plans. And because the CPL program is a grant-making program, we do not know at the time of appropriation recommendation how those activities will fall out, because the applications have not yet been received to apply to that grant program.
Okay,
we will know retrospectively, and we'll be able to provide the information once those grants have been awarded.
Representative Clark.
So, Mr. Chairman, if I understand, that number could go up or down, that percentage could go up or down based on how the grants are applied, is that right?
Assistant Director
McNamara,
Coop.
Thank you.
Representative Clark, those numbers will go up.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. Additional questions? Continue.
Then if you'd
I'm sorry. Director Johnson, you are ready to walk into the bill is the next thing?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Why don't we start the walk through the bill? Members, they'll begin to walk through the individual items on the bill. Director Johnson, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. All right, starting on line 1.21, the total appropriation for this bill is, at the recommendation of the council, is $100,008,000. That's subdivision one. Subdivision two jumps right into the first section of that, which is the prairies, at $40,948,000. The 2A is the DNR Wildlife Management Area and Scientific Natural Acquisitions, Phase 7. This is for $4.57 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources to acquire land in fee for wildlife management areas, to acquire land in fee for scientific and natural area purposes, with the priorities given to lands that are eligible for Native Prairie Bank and lands adjacent to protected Native Prairie. 2B is the accelerating the wildlife management area acquisition phase 7. As we mentioned earlier, a lot of these are projects or program oriented, so that's why the phase is here. This is for $7.452 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for an agreement with Pheasants Forever to acquire land in fee for wildlife management purposes, or wildlife management area purposes, priority given again to acquisition of lands that are eligible for Native Prairie Bank and or lands adjacent to protected native prairie. 2C is the Minnesota Prairie Recovery Project, Phase 6, for $4.032 million. 2, the Commissioner of Natural Resources for agreement with the Nature Conservancy to acquire native prairies, wetlands, and savanna, and restore enhanced grasslands, wetlands, and savanna, with priority, again, to acquisition of lands that are eligible for Native Prairie Bank, and you'll see that's a recurring theme here, or lands adjacent to protected native prairie. 2D is the Northern Tallgrass Prairie National Wildlife Refuge land acquisition. This is for $3.43 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for an agreement with the Nature Conservancy in cooperation with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service to acquire land in fee or permanent conservation easements within the Northern Tallgrass Prairie Habitat Preservation Area in western Minnesota, for addition to the National Tallgrass Prairie National Wildlife Refuge, again with priority to those Native Prairie Bank land, potential lands, and lands adjacent to protected native prairie. 2E is accelerated Native Prairie Bank protection for $3.74 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources to implement the Minnesota Prairie Conservation Plan through acquisition of permanent conservation easements to protect native prairie and grasslands. Because this is an easement program, up to $165,000 is for establishment of a monitoring and enforcement program, or plan, I should say. 2F is the Minnesota Buffers for Wildlife and Water, Phase 5, $4.544 million to the Board of Soil and Water Board of Soil to acquire permanent conservation easements to protect and enhance habitat by expanding the Clean Water Fund riparian buffers program for an equal or for at least equal wildlife benefits for buffers of private lands, up to $72,500 for establishing the monitoring fund and enforcement fund. 2G is the Cannon River Water Headwaters Habitat Complex, Phase 5. This is for $1.38 million to the Commissioner for an agreement with Trust for Public Lands to acquire and restore lands in the Cannon River watershed for wildlife management purposes. 2H is Prairie Chicken Habitat Partnership of the Southern Red River Valley. It's for $1.8 million to the Commissioner for an agreement with Pheasants Forever in cooperation with the Prairie Chicken Society to acquire and restore lands in the Southern Red River Valley for wildlife management purposes. 2I is the protecting and restoring Minnesota's important bird areas. This is $1.73 million to the Commissioner for agreements to acquire conservation easements within important bird areas in areas identified in the Minnesota Prairie Conservation Plan, and it breaks down with $480,000 to the to Audubon of Minnesota, $1.322 million in the to the Minnesota Land Trust, of which $100,000 is to establish a monitoring and enforcement plan. 2J, Wild Rice River Corridor Habitat Restoration. It's for $2.27 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for an agreement with Wild Rice River Watershed District to acquire land in fee and permanent conservation easements and restore river and related habitat in the Wild Rice River Corridor. 2K is Accelerated Prairie Restoration Enhancement on DNR Lands, Phase 7. For $4.88 million to the Commissioner to accelerate the restoration and enhancement of prairie communities on wildlife management areas, scientific and natural areas, state forest lands, and land under Native Prairie Bank easements. 2L, is Enhanced Public Land Grasslands, Phase 2. This is $1.12 million to the Commissioner for an agreement with Pheasants Forever to enhance and restore habitat on public lands. And then we jump into subsection 3, which is our forests. 3A is protecting forest wildlife habitat. I'm sorry, the subsection 3 is a total of $14.822 million. 3A is protecting forest wildlife habitat in the Wild Rice River watershed. This is for $2.188 million to the commissioner for an agreement with the White Earth Nation to acquire lands in fee to be managed for wildlife habitat purposes. 3B is the Camp Ripley Partnership, Phase 5. This is for $1.5 million to Bowser in cooperation with Morrison County Soil and Water Conservation District to acquire permanent conservation easements within the boundaries of the Minnesota National Guard compatible use buffer to protect forest wildlife habitat. Up to $55,000 is for establishment of monitoring enforcement fund. 3C is Southeast Minnesota Protection and Restoration Phase 3. This is for $2.91 million to the commissioner for an agreement with Nature Conservancy to acquire land in fee for wildlife management purposes, to acquire lands in fee for scientific and natural areas and for state forest purposes, and to enhance grasslands, forests, and savanna. 3D is protecting pineland sands, aquifer, forest lands. That's a mouthful. Phase 2. This is for $2.18 million to the commissioner to acquire forest lands in Cass and Wadena counties for wildlife management purposes and to acquire lands in fee for state forests. 3E is protecting key forest lands in Cass County, and this is Phase 6. It's for $442,000 to the Commissioner of Natural Resources in agreement with Cass County to acquire land in fee in Cass County for forest wildlife habitat and to prevent forest fragmentation. 3F is Critical Shoreland Protection Program Phase 3. It's for $1.69 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources in agreement with Minnesota Land Trust to acquire permanent conservation easements along rivers and lakes in the northern forest region. Up to $220,000 is for establishment of monitoring and enforcement fund, as approved again in state law, Minnesota statutes. 3G is the Mississippi Headwaters Habitat Partnership. It's for $961,000 to the commissioner to acquire lands in fee and for permanent conservation easement in the Mississippi Headwaters and for agreements as follows. $1.217 million to the Trust for Public Lands, $824,000 to Minnesota Land Trust, of which up to $80,000 is for establishment of monitoring and enforcement fund. 3H, Southeast Forest Habitat Enhancement, is for $910,000 to the commissioner to enhance forests in southeastern Minnesota. And now we jump into subsection 4. Which is wetlands, a total of $20,390,000 in this subsection. And 4A is accelerating the waterfall production areas acquisition phase 7. This is $7.62 million to the commissioner for an agreement with Pheasants Forever to acquire land in fee to be designated and managed as waterfall production areas in Minnesota in cooperation with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. 4B is the Living Shallow Lakes and Wetlands Initiative, Phase 5, $9.04 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for an agreement with Ducks Unlimited to acquire land in fee for wildlife management purposes. 4C is Wild Rice Shoreland Protection Program, Phase 4. It's for $131,000 to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for acquisition of land in fee, $1.469 million to Bowser to acquire permanent conservation easements for wild rice lake shoreland habitat for native wild rice bed protection. Of that amount, up to $90,000 is to Bowser for the establishment of monitoring enforcement fund. 4D is $2.13 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for to enhance and restore shallow lakes statewide. I'm sorry, that was Accelerated Shallow Lakes and Wetlands Enhancement Phase 7. Now we're into subsection 5, which is habitats, total of $22,368,000 within the subsection, the first of which is 5A, DNR Habitat, or Aquatic Habitat Phase 7. It's for $4.54 million to the Commissioner to acquire interest in land in fee and permanent conservation easement for aquatic management purposes. And to restore and enhance aquatic habitat, up to $130,000 is for establishment and monitoring of a monitoring and enforcement fund. Five B is the Metro Big Rivers Partnership. That's for $2 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for agreements to acquire land in fee and permanent conservation easements and to restore and enhance natural systems associated with the Minnesota, Mississippi, and St. Croix Rivers as follows. $475,000 to the Minnesota Valley National Wildlife Refuge Trust, $275,000 to Friends of the Mississippi River, $400,000 to the Great River Greening, $375,000 to Minnesota Land Trust, $475,000 to the Trust for Public Lands, and up to $60,000 is to the Minnesota Land Trust for establishment of monitoring and enforcement fund. 5C is the Minnesota yes. 5C is the Minnesota Trout Unlimited Cold Water Fish Habitat Enhancement and Restoration Phase 7. This is for $1.89 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for an agreement with Minnesota Trout Unlimited to restore and enhance habitat for trout and other species in and along cold water rivers and streams in Minnesota. 5D is Lake Bemidji South Shore Restoration and Enhancement for $1.65 million to the Commissioner for an agreement with the City of Bemidji to restore and enhance fish habitat on Lake Bemidji. 5E, Sandhill River Fish Passage is for $990,000 to the Commissioner for an agreement with the Sandhill River Watershed District to restore fish habitat in the Sandhill River Watershed. 5F is for the Shell Rock River Watershed Habitat Restoration Program Phase 4. This is for $2.414 million to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for an agreement with the Shell Rock River Watershed District to protect, restore, and enhance aquatic habitat in the Shell Rock River Watershed. 5G is for Lake Nokomis Integrated Habitat Enhancement, $444,000 to the Commissioner for an agreement with the Minnesota Parks and Recreation Board to enhance aquatic habitat on Lake Nokomis. 5H is the Conservation Partners Legacy Grant Program. This is a combination of statewide and metro habitat, Phase 7, for $8.44 million to the Commissioner for a program to provide competitive matching grants up to $400,000 to local, regional, state, and national organizations for enhancing, restoring, and protecting forests, wetlands, prairies, and habitat for fish, game, and wildlife in Minnesota. Of this amount, $3.692 million is for grants in the 7-county metropolitan area and cities with a population of 50,000 or greater. The program shall also, there's a 10% match from non-state sources for all of these grants within this program, and those can be cash or in-kind resources. Subdivision 6 comes next. It is for a total of $1.48 million, and the 6A is contract management. This is for $150,000 to the Commissioner of Natural Resources for contract management duties assigned under this section. 6B is to the Legislative Coordinating Commission for $608,000 in the first year and $607,000 in the second year to LCC for administrative expenses of the Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage Council for compensation and expenses and reimbursement for council members. And 6C is technical evaluation panel for $100,000 to the commissioner for a technical evaluation panel to conduct up to 10 restoration evaluations underneath statute. 6E is legislative legacy website. This is $15,000 appropriation to the LCC for website, which is again required under statute. And subdivision 7 is availability of appropriation. As you can see, unless otherwise provided, it's the amounts of the section are available as of June 30th, 2018, until 2018, and later with other caveats. Subdivision 8 is payment conditions and capital equipment expenditures. Again, on a reimbursement basis, unless otherwise provided in this section. Subdivision 9 for mapping, each direct recipient of the money basically must provide geographic information to the council for mapping of lands acquired in fee with these funds. And then we get into changes to Minnesota statutes. So we have subdivision 8, which is revenues. That's on page 20 of your handout, starting with line 20.1. And this amendment, in summary, Mr. Chair, summary?
Yeah, Director, if you could tell us, you've made a change here, and maybe you could just let members know what you're doing. You're now dealing with some changes from previous law, and maybe you could walk through those. You've moved from this year's appropriation into some updates on previous previous Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage actions, and it's some updates on those. So if you could walk through each one of them rather shortly.
Will do, Mr. Chair. These are from the council's recommendation. With regards to revenues under subdivision 8 of 97A.056, there was the council became aware that previously, if lands were purchased by an NGO or by the state with funds from the Outdoor Heritage Fund, there were requirements to report expenses to those lands for restoration. There were requirements to report revenues that came from those properties, and if there were any net revenues left over when you put the revenues versus those expenses. There was no direction as to where those dollars were to go from there. This is to basically make sure the dollars follow the land, and with the major portion being the last paragraph of this, which is the owner of the land shall submit the total net revenues determined under paragraph A, clause 3, to the state no later than 60 days after the land is transferred to the state. So it's clarifying those dollars follow the
land.
Thank
you.
Okay. Subdivision 20 is regarding donations. And again, this section, in essence, is attempting to clarify and segregate compensations and relationships within and around acquisition activities, basically shedding greater daylight on everything for better public disclosure. Subdivision 21 is haying and grazing. This is was rider language previously on each individual proposal, and now is being put in just as a general, so it will be applied uniformly
okay.
in the future. And last item we have is basically section 6 of Minnesota law 2014's chapter 256. It's habitats, subdivision 5 habitats. Pardon me as I turn to that myself on page 21. And this is previously the terms, the allowance of acquiring permanent conservation easement was not placed in this DNR aquatic habitat phase 6 appropriation. That was an oversight by the council as well as DNR, so it's an attempt to fix that. And because it also includes easements at this point, the $32,500 is for the enforcement and monitoring fund to make sure that's covered. Mr. Chair, if there's anything else you'd like me to...
No, I think you've got it, Director Johnson.
Thank you.
Representative Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just had a question right now on page 20 where it talks about donations. And I think that's good to have in there, but I'm wondering, was there a problem with that? Is that why it came up?
Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair, Representative Green, the chair may have some further comment to this as well, but there was a discussion with regarding the Mississippi Mississippi project with one NGO that had a very close relationship with the seller of the property. And those questions led to the discussion of whether there was any improprieties that happened or not. I think the answer was they felt there were not, but there should be better disclosure to make sure that everybody realizes what the relationships are in these large acquisitions or large projects that happen. Mr. Chair?
Yeah, thank you, Director Johnson. Representative Green, and to the members, previous Chair Wagenius and myself have both been troubled by some relations that sometimes develop in these a few of these rather large projects, specifically LaSalle Lake and Mississippi Northwoods come to mind, where donations were made from the seller of the land to the NGO that facilitated the transaction. So in LaSalle Lake, there was a, Representative Hancock, correct me if I'm wrong, it was your bill, about $8.7 million total was spent, and there was a significant donation by the private landowner to the NGO. That was how that transaction, that's how that NGO was paid in that case. Arguably, I think, and Representative Wagenius first brought this to my attention when I chaired the committee in the previous time, that we should visit this and look at this. The NGO involved has changed their processes and will not use a model in the future that allows them to get more than their actual cost. They had costs in the transaction and lots of costs to facilitate the transaction. We just didn't think it was right that they should get what we thought ended up really being state money back to them beyond what their cost to do the transactions. To their side of the discussion, when they tried to facilitate a transaction that didn't happen, they incurred costs and didn't get compensated. So that's the gist of where this one is coming from. I commend the NGO, it was Trust for Public Land, correct, for coming back and saying, you know what, we understand in a bipartisan way some folks have not liked that model. We're going to change it, and they're using a more traditional model now where they get compensated. This is to clarify that what they're doing. And if folks have questions on it, I would suggest that they chat with Trust for Public Land about it and understand what they're doing, because it was a significant change. There was two rather large projects, LaSalle Lake for $8.7 million and Mississippi Northwoods for $11 million, where they were involved. And so that's what that's about. I don't know, Representative Hansen, or if anybody wants to add to what I'm saying there, Director Johnson, but that's kind of the gist of it. Representative Hansen, and then we'll come back to you, Representative Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Representative Green and the committee. The council has spent I don't know how many hours talking about direct and necessary costs of what should be applicable in these transactions. And the language that's here is something that, after listening to this, and we don't want somebody making money off of this. The fund was established by the voters, and we need to make sure that the integrity is there of that, and if there's receipts that come in, that they cover the costs and not anything else. So the language that you have in front of you is after hours, if not days, Representative McNamara, of talking about direct and necessary costs, and I think we'll hear about direct and necessary costs in other bills as well. But I think to keep the contract with the voters on this, we need to have this language put into statute, and the council made that recommendation.
And Representative Green, the other side of that is we still want to allow people to make donations to Trust for Public Lands or whatever group they are. And so that, it was a tough one to walk through, but a really important one. Representative Green, follow up.
Not on that. I got another question.
Go ahead.
I'll wait till that's resolved.
You got the floor. Representative Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and Representative Hansen and Mr. Johnson for that explanation. I appreciate that. The other question is on page 17, you talk about you have up to 5 years to spend the money. Is there a great deal of money sitting out there on the table right now that was appropriated in the past and hasn't been spent, and if so, how much?
Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair, Representative Green, with regards to the with regards to our bottom line, no, there's not a great deal of money. There is money that's been appropriated that hasn't been spent yet because projects are ongoing. But with regards to page 17, I think you're referring to the LCC portion. Is that correct? Or are you looking at the yes?
Representative Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. From lines 17, 22, and over to 18, too, it talks about how there's, in certain cases, you have till 2018, 2019, or 2020, or 5 years, whichever is longer. And then the reason that I brought that up is because there's a little further up on 17.5, there's $100,000 in the first year for evaluation of panel conduct up to 10 restoration evaluations. And what struck me, and maybe I'm off base here, but you're doing a study when and then you've got 5 years to spend the money. If you're doing the studies beforehand, you should know what's there. Why is it taking so long to disperse it out?
Director Johnson, maybe you first can you do it however you want. Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair, Representative Green, I'll mention just a little bit, and I'll defer to Ms. Koop here, see if she has any further comment. But the first of all, the technical evaluations are done after projects are finalized. So that's very much is looking at those restoration projects after they are finalized. There is an amount of time to, in this case, you can see up to 5 years for appropriations to be spent totally by their by the recipients, and a lot of that is the main reason is because it's all on a reimbursement basis, so it takes a little while. Restorations especially, sometimes the weather isn't right for you to be able to use fire for restoring prairie, or for even getting into a brushland area might not have a good frost or a good freeze in the winter, so you can't get in the equipment to actually do the shearing that's necessary and so on. So there are appropriated dollars that are it takes a little while to get them through the pipeline to get it all spent. Ms. Koop, do you have further comment on that?
Mr. Chair.
Director Koop.
Representative Green. Mr. Johnson is correct. Many of the restorations.
Ms. Koop, you might need to speak a little more into the mic. Ms. Koop.
Representative McNamara, Representative Green. Many of the restorations take the full 5 years because there are a number of steps involved, particularly if you're moving ground from cropland into some kind of a grassland or a prairie. There'll be multiple steps that need to be taken over the course of many years. And as Mr. Johnson has indicated, as we all know, the weather's been very unpredictable the last 8 years. So it's taken a much longer time. People also want to make sure that the restorations that they put in the ground have been successful. So in some cases, they'll need to make some moderate adjustments to the seed bank, for example, or whatever the restoration activity might be. So this is upon the recommendation of the practitioners in the field that a good 4 to 5 years is necessary to make sure that the restoration takes and holds.
Thank you, Ms. Koop. Follow-up, Representative Green.
I just have one more question for now, and that is the same question I asked the commissioner of the DNR. We've got a lot of land being purchased out of our state every year, and we're in excess now of over 25% into public ownership of our property. And this is going to go on for another 20 years. And I'm wondering, do you have a plan right now? Do you have a goal? Is there a limit where you're going to say we've got enough, or are you just going to just buy as much as you possibly can?
Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair and Representative Green, the council to my understanding, I'll defer to Ms. Coop as well, because she has more historic knowledge of this than I do, just because I'm fairly new to the job. The to my knowledge, the council does not have a acres or total for the life of the amendment for an amount of acres that they want to purchase across the state. What I do understand is from the aspect of as far as what's the pilt liability going to be at the end with regards to the current buying rate that's happening, is it's projected that pilt liability at the end of the time would be about $2 million in total. Now, I don't know how many acres that translates to. I wish I could say that for you, and I could probably look that up. Whether that is an actual goal in number that the council is driving at, I don't believe so. But Ms. Coop, do you have further to add on that?
Chair McNamara, Representative Green. In 2010, the council was directed to undertake a 25-year plan, as were the other legacy funds. And the plan that the council undertook was one of not necessarily having goals stated within the plan, but it was a framework to study the possibility of what the landscape might look like should dollars be placed in certain activities. I can provide you a copy of that plan, which we'll go through. There's a lot of data included in there. But the council itself has never sat down and beyond a visioning document for each ecological section, they have not ever stated what those goals of acquisition or restoration or enhancement might be. I think it's important to remember that the projects that are put forward by applicants are those for strategic acquisitions. So it's not, I don't believe the intent is to simply buy land to buy land, but to buy the best possible natural resource land that's available using the concept of a willing seller with no eminent domain in practice.
Members, just to let folks know that we are going to move this bill today, and my definition of today is includes this evening. Both caucuses have caucus at 4:45 tonight, so we'll come back right around the dinner hour if we don't get done, and it's important that we have the discussion here. So I just want members to know that we have a number of significant amendments coming forward that we need to discuss, and there's some folks that have come a very long distance for this bill, and it would not be right for them tomorrow. And tomorrow we have the LCCMR bill, so I don't mean that to impede anybody's discussion, but we do need to do the bill before midnight tonight. Representative Green, follow up. Okay, thank you. Representative Fabian.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Johnson, kind of a follow-up on what Representative Green was talking about. As I've stated in the past, I do have some reservations about the acquisitions, not because of the benefit to the environment and so forth, but because of the effect that it may have on local governments, townships, counties, school districts, hospital districts, ditch authorities, and so forth, when it comes to having lands come off the tax base. And that's a real long discussion, but I'm curious to know if the Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage Council has addressed or is planning to address the pressure that's being placed upon the state's general fund to make the pilt payments. I'm concerned about the sustainability of all this over the next 20 years. So I'm curious to know what steps the Lessard, the Outdoor Heritage Council might be taking to make some recommendations.
Representative Fabian and Director Johnson, if I could just weigh in real quickly. Both Chair Dill last year and Chair Kahn expressed an interest in having a discussion of dealing with the ongoing pilt obligations created by purchases of land by Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage and LCCMR. And I know the townships, counties, and folks are working on a proposal to deal with that, and I do anticipate we will hear that proposal in this committee this year and have discussion of proposals to deal with that. We've had that discussion at Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage Council. I brought that up to let them be aware of that discussion, and it's not only former Chair Dill and Kahn's feelings on that issue, but I have feelings that we need to express and deal with that issue. Do you have any further comment on that, Director Johnson?
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Fabian, just very short, just to let you know that the council, it is a matter of discussion with the council. I would anticipate will be on their agenda in the future meetings, especially with the Representative McNamara and Representative Hansen seated on the council. I do know that they have a concern with regards to the constitutionality of using those dollars for PILT, but that's a discussion that will be taken up in the legislature. And the only reference we have to that is a letter from the AG. And I can get you a copy of that letter if you'd wish, sir.
Follow-up, Representative Fabian.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Mr. Johnson, on page 8 and page 9, at the bottom of the page on the Pinelands Sands Aquifer Forest Land, in that it says that you have an agreement with Cass and Wadena counties, okay? Excuse me, on the top of page 9, it says, in agreement with Cass County. On page 8, it doesn't say anything about an agreement with Cass and Wadena counties. And back to my previous comments, throughout the state of Minnesota, I would encourage the Lessards-Sams Council to make sure that they do acquire and they do work in cooperation with local counties on acquisitions where it involves PILT and those types of things. So I'm curious to know why there is an agreement under E where it says an agreement with Cass County, but under D there is not that language.
Mr. Chair.
Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair, Representative Fabian, these are two different appropriations, and so just to let you know, under E, that is actually the recipient of those dollars would be the county of Cass, and their county land manager would be the one that is the project manager for this. The county of Cass actually has a no net gain proposal for public lands or for county lands. So what they're using this to they're using it toward the purposes of improving their holdings to make sure they have access, make sure they have manageability to their properties. Yeah, and under a no net loss and no net gain, I believe.
A no net gain. Cass County has passed a ordinance that they will not have an increase in this. And this money is used to facilitate that, as you said, Director Johnson. So in other words, there will be no net gain of acreage in Cass County for public lands that the county is managing. So in other words, if they're buying some land for a county forest, they're selling some land for county forest.
Mr. Chair, that's what my understanding was. That's what I thought I read. Ms. Coop is deferring, saying it was a no net loss. I will find that out and get that information to you.
Oh, okay.
For right. Sure.
We'll get that clarified. Thank yes. you. Representative Fabian.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Then real quickly, on a few of the sections, F, for example, on page 9, G on page 9, there's appropriation in there to establishing monitoring and enforcement fund. I'm wondering who is going to be doing the monitoring and the enforcement fund, how it's going to be accounted for, and you talked a little bit about constitutionality of PILT payments and so forth coming from here. Where do we have the flexibility in the language to insert this into the bill?
Director Johnson.
Mr. Chair and Representative Fabian, and I'll, if I don't answer fully on this, I'll defer to Ms. Coop as well. But the in these two cases, these two instances with F and G, the recipient or the that $220,000 and the $80,000 will actually be out of the proceeds to Minnesota Land Trust, that they can put that aside into their enforcement and supervision fund. The and they have that invested. That is, it's a very well monitored fund. It's because they are holding some of these easements, as in other cases the DNR holds easements. In other cases, it's Bowser. In this case, the Minnesota Land Trust does. That's part of their business plan. They do it very well, and as I understand, it's been vetted through previous projects with the council. Ms. Coop,
Chair
Director Coop.
Chair McNamara, Representative Fabian, the easement monitoring enforcement fund was put into statute several years ago, and it allows the state, or in this case the NGOs, to undertake continual monitoring as to the integrity of those easements. Should an infraction be found, then this fund would allow for the payment of legal fees or any other professional fees associated with defending the easement. There has been discussion over the last couple of years, and I think it will be taken up again this year, of developing a different kind of system where that instead of the money being dispersed to the individual appropriations and managed by an NGO or by a state, there has been some discussion to have a fund that will be managed on a state level for all conservation easements funded by the Outdoor Heritage Fund and other easements as well. Obviously, there's more power if there's more money together to defend a possible infraction in the future.
And Ms. Koop and Representative Fabian, some of this is reaction to the OLA's report on easements and the lack of uniformity and enforcement of existing permanent easements, spots where people had built buildings, where clearly they couldn't be built, where they had done land changing, land management practices that were not allowed. And so we're trying to be good stewards of this state's money on this. And Representative Hansen, to this point.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Representative Fabian, I think the language you see here is kind of a reaction to the overall issue of the costs that are incurred. And it was an attempt by previous legislatures to recognize that there are costs, particularly on monitoring the easements. So to your question about the constitutionality, it's focusing on the monitoring. It's not mentioning taxes or fees or anything like that. It's taking a portion of that appropriation and making sure that that easement is there for the taxpayers. And so as we've had these discussions, which I know you've been involved with, we've all been involved with, this was a piece of that to try to get that there.
Representative Fabian. Members, I've got, we need DNR to come down and give us an answer, or Director Johnson or Assistant Director Koop, on Representative Johnson's question about cities of 50,000. Then I have three other questions. And then I do want to take Representative Green's, is it the A4, before we break at 10 o'clock, so that there's some folks that have come down in regards to the A4 that have driven a long distance. I'd like to get to that before we recess. Welcome to the committee. If you could identify yourself for the record.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and members. Grant Wilson, Minnesota Department of Natural Resources, Division of Fish and Wildlife. Just have a quick response to the question on CPL Metro dollars. I don't have all the details, but just in a quick phone call, learned that we did have one project funded in St. Cloud and Rochester, so one project funded so far in each of those communities. And we have one additional grant application from each of those communities as well. We also have one grant application currently under consideration from Duluth. I'm not aware of any applications from Mankato currently, but I also don't think that Mankato is considered to be qualified under the 50,000 and up language. So and we have had outreach efforts and events in all those communities.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Representative Johnson.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and I can see the confusion, and I know there's a 24-hour rule, and I was wondering if the committee would be open to an amendment that I think would improve the language in that area, because both it identifies, this is somewhat limiting because it limits it to the cities the way I read it, and the seven county metropolitan area is not limited to only cities as I would read it. And so I don't know if we're open to an amendment on that or not. I defer to your judgment. But so to say instead of cities with a population of 50,000 or greater, rather say metropolitan statistical areas outside the metropolitan area, seven county metropolitan area, which I think would be would include the recently nascent Mankato, North Mankato area, but also would expand for area. Would expand the geography for cities like St. Cloud, Rochester, and Duluth as well.
And Mr. Wilson, if you and or Assistant Commissioner Meyer could work with Representative Johnson on what his concerns are and what communities could be impacted with that? Does that mean potentially Moorhead would be one of those now that becomes within that 50,000? And what was the intention of that to include them in? Was it just cities of the first class, or that's not what it says, but what were your intentions? So why don't you discuss with Representative Johnson as we move forward on that issue? Representative Heckbarth.
I'll pass to the leader.
Representative Hausman.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I just wanted to follow up a little more on the issue that Representative Green referenced earlier in observing the various dates when money is available. In general obligation bonding, in law, they're just all treated automatically the same 4 years, and they automatically cancel, and you'd have to make a case. But is that not the case here, and you have to write it in every point? And if you don't write it in, is it available forever, or what?
Assistant Director Koop.
Chairman McNamara, Representative Hausman, as I stated earlier, the dates for availability are there based upon the activity. So it will vary depending upon the intent of the appropriation. If it's an appropriation is to acquire land and restore it, they will have 5 years. If it's just a restoration enhancement, they will also have 5 years. If it's a simple straight-up acquisition program with no restoration involved, then they have 3 years to complete the activity.
Mr.
Representative Hausman.
Even though it's not mentioned in here, there's an underlying law, in other words, that determines that.
Director Koop.
Chairman McNamara, Representative Hausman, my understanding is that unless there's a specific rider language attached to any particular recommendation, the Subdivision 7 stands and is the subdivision that directs how long the money is available.
Does that make sense, Representative Hausman?
Yes, I was just looking for confirmation here.
And it looked like our researcher was nodding approval to that. Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Chair, members, if you turn to page 17 on lines 26 through 28, it says, unless otherwise provided, the amounts in this section are available till June 30th, 2018. I believe that would be the overarching availability that you were referencing.
Right.
You, Representative Hausman.
But, Mr. Chair, my point is, if something isn't referenced at all, is there in law somewhere else a date by which, if something is not encumbered, it automatically cancels? In general obligation bonding, if it's not encumbered in 4 years, it automatically cancels.
Ms. Taylor.
Mr. Chair, members, I believe it's 1 year if there's nothing. If Subdivision 7 were not here, it would be 1 year, since most of these appropriations are for the first year.
Thank you. Next, when Representative Dill comes back, he had a question, but we'll move. Representative Green, you have the A4.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'd like to move the A4 amendment. It's a pretty simple amendment. It just takes appropriations from page 7 and moves them to page 11. So you can read that and look through that. The amendment basically redirects the funding from the Wild Rice River Watershed Forest Wildlife Habitat Project on page 7 of the bill to the Accelerated Shallow Lakes and Wetlands Enhancement Project on page 11. And this is to address the problems in Clearwater County. Clearwater County is already tax poor. This is a good chunk of productive land that will be taken off of our tax rolls. Representative Fabian made a good point on when he talked about Cass County and you entering into an agreement with Cass County because they had a no net loss. Clearwater County also has a no net loss that they signed some time back, but they were not contacted on this. They knew nothing about it until the report came out, and there's a lot of concern there. You know, this affects our schools, our roads, everything up there. Our property taxes, our rent for the people that are renting, and it's just a big chunk of land, and I'm going to try to get it out if I can.
Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And, you know, this is unfortunate. What wasn't mentioned is that this is a tribal appropriation. And we've gone through this debate now many times. you could take any of the appropriations in here that are acquisitions and make the same cases, and those cases have been made. But this is the recommendations of the council. We have heard for 6 years that the council recommendations should be followed. I think Governor Dayton vetoed when our side of the aisle made changes to appropriations. And here we have a change to the appropriations to zero out the appropriation to tribal government, which followed the application process, just like the tribal government did in a previous appropriation. The difference is there's been a change in majorities. So I have no illusion that this amendment will fail. I will ask for a roll call. But I think it's a sad day in Minnesota when we continue to go and deal with this issue. And what's different about this appropriation is that this is a tribal appropriation. And so I would oppose the A4 amendment. I know that several of our members want to talk. I would ask, it looks like the appropriation is taken and given to Ducks Unlimited. I think, to be fair, it would be good to have testimony from both White Earth and Ducks Unlimited about this amendment.
Thank you, Representative Hansen. You raised a good question. As Representative Hansen and I and Ms. Coop and the rest of the staff at Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage, you know, this has been an ongoing discussion within Lessards-Sams on both sides of the issue. And Representative Hansen is right that this is a proposal for the tribal nation to get this land in trust. And there's a number of differences. I've been one that's come to realize that these are state monies. They should, for the most purpose, be bought by state entities and end up in state government hands. I think some good exceptions to that are waterfowl production areas that are owned by the federal government. The federal government makes one-time payments at the time of purchase to local units of government, recognizing that pilt won't be paid on that land. We have the example of Crow Wing County ended up with a forested land in the Mississippi Northwoods. When that was happening, I thought maybe this is a good solution to have the county own that land. I did also have concerns that I thought the land that abutted Highway 210 would end up getting developed. And actually, through a series of maneuvers, completely legal, that property along 210 will be sold by the county, and the county will get the net gain on that property sold for commercial purposes. And the state of Minnesota that gave the land to Crow Wing County doesn't get anything. I think it serves as an example when the state buys this land, or we buy this land in this bill and have different entities own it. In this case, the tribal government doesn't pay pilt. Potlatch is currently paying $12,000 taxes on this land, and we'll hear from the DNR about this proposal, both in what the hunting regulations would be different and on the pilt payment. But if I'm not mistaken, the pilt payment, if DNR owned it, would be more than the real estate taxes. I may be wrong, but I believe it's 0.75% of the purchase price, depending on what the land use is. I should qualify, we'll get from DNR what that is. So this is a big discussion. This is not an anti-Native American proposal. This is a question of should local units of government be ended up getting this land when they can do things different that may not be what the intention of the amendment was that passed by the folks in 2008. It's been clearly known that the tribal government does not do intend to hunt this land as it would be hunted if it was DNR land. And there is an exclusion in law that allows local units of government to pass laws to restrict the hunting or the fishing or whatever, the taking of game. I don't believe the intention was that folks would do that other than for things like safety. We bought land at the Arboretum, the University of Minnesota land at the Arboretum. It's got restrictions on hunting there. The reality is, if we're going to have a hunt there for deer, we need to make sure that the people are all away from the land surrounding that, and we have to close the access to public and all that. That's not what this case is. This is a different case there. So, Representative Hansen, you're right. This is a tough issue, and it raises a number of questions, and we'll have a good discussion here about that. With that, members, why don't we hear from, I've got three people, Representative Purcell, Representative Hornstein, and Representative Fabian. Then I would like both the tribe and offer the county, if they're here, and or DNR to answer questions that members may have. Representative Purcell, you're next.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I want to listen to the discussion. I've heard some things that I guess I wasn't aware that might be involved in this. I heard some hunting, fishing things. And if you'd indulge me for a minute or two, I'd like to give you a little bit of history about this lake, Lower Rice Lake, 2,000 acres of wild rice, and how there wasn't a stock of wild rice back in the 60s and 70s after an egg farm upstream polluted it with chicken manure and took out all the rice. Took out every bit of rice in that lake. I don't know, Representative Green, if you recollect that, but I sure do. I was working for the tribe. I was part of that restoration effort. Well, we got the egg farm shut down. They could have done right and not polluted in the first place, but they chose to shut down. Rerouted the river, put it back where it was supposed to be, so it was going through a big wetland to absorb those nutrients. And now there's several million dollars worth of rice growing again there. It was all nutrient related. So my take on this is, White Earth is trying to protect the resource. And if they have the property, the resource is going to be protected. They know what happens when the resource is in other hands, when the land is in other hands. They know. We got history. So that's my take on this. That's why I would oppose the Green Amendment and support that White Earth be allowed to proceed with this land purchase and protect the wild rice in the lake. And you look at that lake, White Earthers are the only ones that can go into that lake, unless you or I would go get a permit from the tribal government as a special harvester, which you can do, you know, and maybe as a state rep you could get a, you know, a little special condition to do that. I don't know. But you have to be White Earth to rice on this lake. So it's theirs to protect for themselves, and the economic benefit that those couple million pounds of rice brings about, that's a big benefit for the White Earth Nation. So that's my take on it. I don't see hunting and fishing on this. I know most of that property. I've hunted over there with a group out of Natawash for several decades, and know most of that area. And this is about protecting wild rice. I would urge you to vote against the Green Amendment.
Thank you. Representative Hornstein.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I guess I think this is very important in terms of Representative Purcell's observation that this is hugely important to the tribal economy. And I also want to echo what Representative Hansen said, because putting this amendment on could potentially imperil the entire bill. You know, we have precedent with that in terms of Governor Dayton's response to, you know, what happened when the legislature mucked with the Lessards-Sams recommendations. So I have real concerns that if this amendment goes on, this entire bill could really be sabotaged. But I think there's a broader issue, too, and I would ask the author of the amendment a question here, and that is, Representative Green, did you contact the tribal government prior to introducing this amendment today?
Representative Green.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Representative Hornstein, I have spoken with the tribal government. For the record, I'm a member of the White Earth Nation. So if this goes into effect, I can go rice on the lake if I want. This is not about tribal government. It's not about some of the things you guys are talking about here. It's about a piece of land in a tax-poor county. And as a tribal member who owns property, I can tell you property taxes are killing us. And just in Clearwater County, you know, I don't know what you think about the people on White Earth, but they do own property. They are responsible, wonderful citizens, and this is going to affect them whether they're tribal or not. They're going to pay higher taxes. If they're renting in Clearwater County, their rent will go up because of this. And if it doesn't, it's going to affect the schools, which have both tribal and non-tribal members in, or, you know, students in the schools. This is a matter of, if you look across the north part of our state, and the land that's disappearing up there is unbelievable. I think Clearwater County is 40% now in public hands. Manoman County is 25. Up in Representative Dill's area, there's places that are 80% in public lands. How much is enough? That's the question. You know, we pride ourselves in this country on our ability to be free and to own property. Well, now the state just continues to take more and more and more, and if you resist, you're labeled as a racist or a radical. But this is our heritage, is to, you know, the American dream, to be able to own your own home and to succeed and to move forward. But we're losing that, and we're losing it big time in the North Country. We have no place for our young people now that can even afford to go buy land because the land prices are so high. And that is what I'm trying to correct.
Mr. Chair, that's helpful to know that
Representative Hornstein.
And we'll hear from the tribe, I think, but it's helpful to know that you had contacted them. But I just have, there's another concern as well, another layer of all this, my understanding is this land may have been, historically, part of the White Earth nation, and I don't know if it gets into some, historic issues with treaties, et cetera, but I think we're just wading into some really difficult and unprecedented territory here, and so I have real concerns, and I'll be joining my colleagues in voting no, but I would like to hear again, I think, from the county and the tribe about this.
Yeah. If we could have come forward, Ms. Vogt from who's a land manager with the White Earth Tribe, she has let us know that she would like to comment on this amendment. And then I'm not aware of anyone else that has said they want to weigh in on this amendment. Is there anyone else in the public? Is anyone here from Clearwater County? Any members of the public, if you could just raise your hand if there's anyone else, or if after the tribe speaks, if you could let the page know you need to speak on this amendment. Welcome to the committee. If you could identify yourself for the record.
Good morning, Mr. Chair and members. My name is Lorena Vogt.
Ms. Vogt, could you pull the mic a little closer and then start again?
Good morning, Mr. Chair and members. My name is Lorena Vogt. I'm the tribal land manager for White Earth Natural Resources, and thank you for having me here today.
And why don't you go ahead with your presentation? Do you have some comments on what you've heard so far? And if you could be rather quickly sum up the nation's concerns with this amendment.
I do have some comments. The fact is, this is a great project. When you're looking at Lessards-Sams dollars, and we can get acres of land for $1,000 an acre, I think that's spectacular. Considering the various scopes of projects, the Lessards-Sams dollars are going farther in this project. Also, there is a need for hunting properties and recreation properties in this vicinity, not only for tribal members, but for all members of the community. And the fact is, we have a great natural resource department. We care and we have common goals with Lessards-Sams. We have the abilities and the resources to manage this property on behalf of all the communities and all members of the communities, whether they're tribal or not. So, and when you're looking at the taxation, I personally have not spoke with Mr. Green, so I was not approached on this. I had just received the letter from Clearwater County. I think it's unfortunate. There is a lot of projects that are in this bill that are not directly affiliated with the state. We have Ducks Unlimited, Pheasants Forever. If they are, the parcels are purchased within their projects, it will be taken off the tax rolls, as well as White Earth Nation's projects. So we are not the only project that is in this bill that this would be the results. When you're looking at $12,000 to $15,000 in taxes, I do understand your concern. I'm looking at the benefits for the communities and for the people in the communities. I can speak from personal experience. My family, we have tribal members and we have non-members, all in one family. We're all integrated, the communities and our families. And having a property like this to where we can all go to and be welcome and it can be used for everyone, I think is, it only brings us one step further in government and uniting us. So
thank you.
I think it would be unfortunate for it to be removed.
How about if we hear from former Representative Haas next? If you could identify yourself for the record.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm Bill Haas, representing White Earth Tribal Nation. And a couple things that I've been talking to some members have brought up questions. First of all, hunting and fishing. You know, there's issues about, well, the band can shut off hunting and fishing to non-tribal members, things like that. If that scenario would happen in the future, White Earth would have to pay back the $2.1 million to the state. So White Earth is committed to manage this land for use for hunting for members and non-members of the band. So I think that's, you know, and through the last number of years, we have worked, White Earth has, with the state of Minnesota on partnerships. And we have worked to save the state and the county's money with the partnerships we've worked with them on. A recent project that we just completed was the transfer of the human service services for Clearwater, Becker, and Manoman County to White Earth Tribal Nation for tribal members. That has significantly saved those three counties money by doing this, and it has saved the state millions of dollars in doing this. But it has also provided better services to tribal members. We've had a partnership with the DNR on a fire station that we took over. We operate now and run for the DNR. They house their fire people there during the summer so that if there's forest fires or grass fires in the area, they have their people along with White Earth people to go out and fight the fires. So we're a little different than the other tribes because we're working and reaching out to the state and the state is reaching out to us for projects. The other thing is with the purchase of this land, it would go into trust, and that's just the way it has to be with the different laws that they're governed under. But if White Earth decides in the future that we do not want to manage this property anymore, then it would leave trust status and go back to the DNR. So it's the state is not losing. The people in Minnesota are not losing on this. It's just that White Earth has stepped forward and said, we want to preserve the rice in Wild Rice Lake. We want to preserve that watershed so it doesn't get contaminated, so we can continue to have a good revenue source for the people up there and can generate some income from it. But they also are good stewards of the land, and they want to protect it, and they want to take care of it, and they want to leave it in its natural state. So that is why this project is so important to White Earth, because it also benefits the state of Minnesota and the people of Minnesota. So we appreciate, you know, a no vote on this amendment.
Thank you. Representative Fisher.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Question for, and I don't know which of our testifiers will be best on this, is I hear a little bit about the management for long term. Kind of like to know, I understand right now there are forest lands up there that you're being protected. I'd kind of like to know a little bit more is what your long term goals are for it. And then also I've heard a little bit that there might be some of this is threatened by development and what kind of development it might be. This helps give me a little bit idea of what we're trying to protect here.
We do have a Ms. Vogt, manager. Mr. Chair and members, we do have a forestry department, and they actually our integrated resource management plan and the states is actually they reflect off each other. We do have common goals. We do have plans in place. And as for potential development, could you please clarify development on the properties in question?
Mr. Chair,
Representative Fish.
Yep, thank you, Mr. Chair, Ms. Volk. Kind of wondering is, if this is not bought and purchased and put in protection, what kind of development things could happen to the land? Are there other sellers out there that could end up buying it? What might they end up doing with that?
Ms. Volk.
Mr. Chair and representatives, The fact is that it Potlatch has had this land on the market for some time. It would be open to private ownership, and therefore it would not be open to public hunting or any conservation practices. So we stepped in, we saw a great project, and that had the common goals for Lessards-Sams, and we would love to pick it up and put it into conservation for everyone.
Mr. Haas.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. One of the things that I've noticed, and I have a lake home up on Lake Mille Lacs, and I've noticed in snowmobiling the last two winters, all the woodland areas that have been clear-cutted and turned into farmland. And I'm concerned that with this piece of property, if these different pieces of property are sold off, what is to prevent somebody from clear-cutting the land and turn it into beet production, wheat production, potatoes, you know, whatever would grow on that land up there? And then what would be the negative impact to the Wild Rice River and to the Rice Lake with the nutrients that would come from the fertilizers and the chemicals used in the production of that? So, and that would then negatively impact the fact that no more hunting on the property, you wouldn't have access to the property, and we could have a future problem to deal with that would White Earth would have to work with.
Thank you. Follow-up, Representative Fisher.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Not so much follow-up as a comment along the lines as it seems to me this is an area where it fits with Lessards-Sams. We're trying to protect forest lands that have been under, as the change economies occurred, and we find that the timber industry does not need as many lands. They're letting these go in many instances. Some of these are becoming into different production values, which will have impacts on the land. So I can see the value of this and how it ties things together, and I would urge no vote on the amendment. Thank you.
Representative Purcell.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Just ask for a roll call on this amendment, please.
Yep, and Representative Hansen has already done that. Sir. Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And is there anyone from Ducks Unlimited here?
I do not see Mr. Snyder. Is anyone in the audience from Ducks Unlimited? No. Representative Hansen.
And Mr. Chair, and maybe Representative Green, have you talked to anyone from Ducks Unlimited since you're taking the money from this council-approved unanimous recommendation and giving it to Ducks Unlimited?
Mr. Chair, Representative Hansen, no, I haven't. And where I was looking to put this money was somewhere where it wouldn't be acquiring land for fee. And as long as I have the floor, I'll address the fact that thank you for coming, by the way, and I would never question Whiter's ability to manage. I mean, I know what you guys do there, but that's not the case. That's not the point here. The point is that the land is in private ownership. It is commercial land now, and it's going to be removed from the tax rolls. As far as farming goes, I don't think that the land there is ever going to be capable of farming. And as far as the forestry goes, as I'm sure Mr. Haas knows and you too, the forests that we have up there are not 100-year forests. They have to be managed. They have to be cut. Because if they're not, within 30 to 40 years, they will rot and fall over and you will have nothing. So the management of the land is very important, and so to think that you're going to preserve the forest exactly the way it is not the case. It has to be rejuvenated, and that's the way life is in our area. So this is and again, this is not about who owns the land, because in my personal opinion, I don't want the DNR to have it either. I think it needs to be in private ownership. You know, there's many other things that we could talk about. Maybe we could talk in private too, but I hope that you guys realize that at some point we're going to have to stop buying land, especially in the northern region of the state. We're running out. So,
Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And for every buyer, there's a seller. There's capitalism occurring here, and you've got a willing seller and a willing buyer. I just want to get on the record. So, Ms. Volk, you followed the process, right? You responded to a request for proposal and testified in front of the council. Is that correct?
Correct.
Ms. Volk. Representative Hansen.
And Mr. Chair, Ms. Volk, you answered many of these same questions, and including the perennial question about wolf hunting and whether or not the tribe pays tribal members pay sales tax. Is that correct?
Mr. Chair,
Ms.
and
Volk.
Members. Correct.
Yes. Representative Hansen, follow up.
And maybe if you could address those issues, just to get them on the table, because I think they're always in the back of people's minds and not at the forefront.
Any additional comment, Manager Volt?
Well, Mr. Chair and members, I know the wolf hunt issue is pretty heated. The fact is that they are back on the endangered species list, so that really would not apply to this grant now anyway. So it's really not a point that would be opposed to this application. We followed everything that the Lessards-Sams required, and we met the needs, and it was deemed a worthy project. Okay. So we're really proud of it, and we will do the best job we can in managing this property.
Thank you.
And just
Representative Hanson.
Finally, Mr. Chair, so, you know, those of us who've been here since the amendment, we've seen letters come from an array of groups to say don't change the council's recommendations. I know some of the people who've signed those letters don't really like these type of appropriations. I would hope that there's consistency among the groups that have said before that shouldn't change the council's recommendations if we embark on that path.
Thank you, Representative Hanson. I have heard from one testifier. Mr. Tamman, if you could come down and identify your for you to the record and give a short testimony.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. I'm Bob Tamman from Sudan, Minnesota, home of Minnesota's first iron mine, and I decided to testify because once again I hear about all the public land we have up north, which is of course true, but one of the reasons we have so much public land is because no one could make any economic benefit out of that land 100 years ago. They tried to drain Coochaching County. It wasn't fit to farm. The land went tax forfeit to the state, so we acquired that land as Minnesotans because nobody else could make a living on it. And another point is, just because that land is in the public domain does not mean it is not available to private development. And I say this because my wife and I own property in Lake County where exploration is going on regularly on our public land. They're drilling for minerals out there. About 4 years ago, we had a barge floating out in the middle of Birch Lake, our public waters, 10 miles south of Ely, drilling into an ore body. Having those as public lands has not taken them out of the possibility of private development. Our public lands are a piggy bank for the logging and mining industries. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Tamman. Seeing no more further discussion, Representative Green renews his motion for the A4. It's been a roll call requested. McNamara votes aye.
Clark.
No.
Cornish.
Aye.
Dill. Fabian.
Aye.
Fenton.
Aye.
Fisher.
No.
Green.
Aye.
Hackbarth.
Aye.
Hancock.
Aye.
Hansen.
No.
Houseman.
No.
Heintzman.
Aye.
Hornstein.
No.
Johnson.
No.
Neuberger.
Aye.
Purcell.
No.
Poppy.
No.
Rarick.
Aye.
Torkelson.
Aye.
Uglum.
Aye.
There being 13 ayes and 8 nays, the amendment is adopted. The next amendment, members, is the A2, and I know Ms. Dyson is in the audience. I think what I'll do, Ms. Taylor, or I'm wondering if, should we have Mr. Hubinger? I'm sorry. Ms. Representative Hausman.
Mr. Chair, I'm just at this moment really sort of blown away, and I wonder whether we'll hear from all those same voices on the Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage Committee, that massive outpouring of opinion the last time we played around with their bill, or whether this will be an exception to the rule. It's going to be very interesting to me whether those same voices who complained last time will will complain about this change we just made.
Thank you for those comments, Representative Hausman. Members, I referred to the wrong amendment. I meant to refer to the A1. We took Representative Green's amendment out of order. The intention was to go in numeric order, but I wanted to offer those folks that traveled from long distance before we recess. Members, the A1... the A1 amendment, members, deals with the makeup of the, how the council is governed, and is deals with the who the director. It clarifies who the director reports to. You know, Mr. Hubinger, maybe I'll have you come down and just if you could walk through. Mr. Hubinger from the LCC is here, and if you could just walk through just in kind of a real short. Factual basis, and then I wanted Ms. Dyson is here because specifically I think Representative Hansen, there's kind of two parts to it. Mr. Hubinger, maybe you can walk through the two parts, and then Representative Hansen I think was interested in possibly hearing from someone like Ms. Dyson on the second part. Mr. Hubinger, if you could identify yourself for the record.
Mr. Chair and members, I'm Greg Hubinger with the Legislative Coordinating Commission. Representative McNamara's amendment makes two substantive changes and then one technical change. The technical change is on page 2, line 21, which just deletes some obsolete language. The first substantive change happens on line 2.25 and would provide for the Legislative Coordinating Commission to appoint staff for the Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage Council. Currently, there's some tension between this existing provision in statute and the council's bylaws about exactly how the director of the council is appointed. And this change would make it clear that it would be the Legislative Coordinating Commission that would be responsible for appointing the director. The director would continue to be responsible for appointing any other staff. Section 4 of the bill deals with the open meeting law and how council members are able to attend other events or conferences or gatherings without creating a quorum issue under the open meeting law. And Ms. Dyson can handle that question, that issue.
I think you've done a real good job, Mr. Hubinger. And I don't see, oh, Representative Hansen does have a question. Representative Hansen, it looks like members, the other amendments may be non-controversial. We may not need to come back in the evening. I've heard from members on both sides of the aisle of conflicts tonight, and it looks like we might be able to work our way through this. Representative Hansen.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And Mr. Hubinger, on the LCC, my questions are specifically, how does it work? I know we've just had a change with like the sergeant's office, and could you maybe walk through some examples? I know when we have the audit commission does the hiring, and that's under the legislative control. But can you give me some examples of where the LCC, which I think only meets a couple times a year, where there's actually a hiring done of nonpartisan staff?
Mr. Hubinger.
Mr. Chair and Representative Hansen, a recent example might be the appointment of the director of the Legislative Water Commission, where there was a nonpartisan staff group that did the initial screening of candidates and conducted the interviews. And there was a subgroup of the Water Commission that met and conducted a second interview. The final decision was made by the LCC, by the LCC chair.
Representative Hansen.
And then, Mr. Chair, is it your intent? I see we have like an automatic effective or immediate effective date. Is this prospective? I know we've got, you know, Mr. Johnson was just up speaking. It's not your intent to go back and do anything with, I don't want to go back through that, but well, just go ahead.
No, you and I both don't want to go back through that because that's why we're here and correcting that, and we're very happy with Mr. Johnson and absolutely not the intention to go backwards. This is prospective fixing, I think, something that's really not intended and is a good, it's good government, actually. We need this amendment, and it's a kind of a common sense one. Representative Hansen.
And then, Mr. Chair, and maybe Mr. Hubinger, so a process that, let's say, 20 years or 19 years from now, when we're with 1 year left and we have to hire somebody else, that you would have the same precedent as was done with the Legislative Water Commission, where members of the council would be involved in the interviewing, but the final authority would be with the LCC. Is that the process that you're thinking of?
Comment, Mr. Hubinger?
Mr. Chair, Representative Hansen, that's correct.
Good, thank you. Representative Dill, last question on this.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I don't think that maybe I just found out that I'm not a part of common sense government with your last comment, because the Water Commission doesn't have $100 million to deal with and to try and figure out how to split up. And in thinking about the LCC, we are allowing then a state bureaucracy to pick a executive director for an organization that works and deals directly with an appointed board by this Senate Majority Leader, the House Speaker, the Governor, and people like that. And just as an example, the last issue, the board themselves had, I think, somewhere in the neighborhood of 52 people that applied, and the board only selected, meaning the Outdoor Heritage Council Board, selected two of them, 2%, or a little less than that, actually, to interview. And then there was the squabble, and they wanted five people, and so you added an additional 0.7%, making near 3%, and then you hired the person that never even was considered in the first go-around. My question is that how is this going to work? And to protect people who voted for a constitutional amendment to collect sales tax for all those years and deal with issues like Representative Green's amendment and others that have come before us, and have a bureaucracy which is administered mainly by people from the Twin Cities area, metropolitan area, because they have to work here. And how is that all going to work? And I don't think that it represents how it should work, and it doesn't represent the needs of my constituents to have an executive director that is being taken care of in this way. Now, I understand the problems you had at the board level in trying to get through this, but that is inherent to the situation. Every day when you get up running a business, it isn't about making money, it's about fixing solutions so that you make some money. Every day is another problem. And that was just another problem in the day of the Lessard Outdoor Heritage Council. And frankly, if you can't stand the heat, then you shouldn't be on it. And I don't agree with that part of the amendment, and it's very often that you and I don't agree, but I just cannot believe we are going to turn around and turn over to the Legislative Coordinating Commission the appointment of someone so important to that fund and to the people of this state and to the people who supported and bought into this concept of preserve, protect, and restore. So with that, at least the way it's currently written, I'm going to oppose the amendment, except that it was amended to say except for the executive director.
Well, Representative Dill, if I can just comment on your comments. One, members, it's important to know that this actually puts it back in elected people's responsibility. The head of the LCC is either the Senate Majority Leader or the Speaker of the House, an elected official, instead of by a body that is the majority of 7 of the 11 members of the Lessards-Sams Outdoor Heritage Council are appointed individuals. It's interesting, none of us in this body hire our legislative assistants. That's done through a process, an employment process, that allows that to take place. It was not a good process, the one that we went through in the hiring. It can be improved. I believe this puts it consistent with other state government. There are a few exceptions, a few other situations where volunteer citizens do hiring. But I would strongly recommend you go back and listen to the proceedings of the numerous meetings we had, and how over and over and over again Mr. Hubinger had to sit at this table and publicly warn the members on the council to not say something that was going to put us in a position of breaking employment law, because we're 7 citizens and 4 legislators, many of us without previous business experience. That doesn't include me. I've hired and fired many people over the years, so I actually had a fairly good idea what we should and shouldn't say. But not having been a business owner for 8 years now, I'm not up to speed on stuff. And so, Representative Dill, I respect where you're coming from. This is actually putting it in the majority, Senate Majority Leader's hands and the Speaker's hands. They're the head of that. And that's where those decisions should be made in an appropriate way. So I respect that this is two sides of an issue that we can differ on. Any additional discussion? You know what, members? We are, as you know, I do not like running over. Is this room? Yeah. Okay. If we don't wrap it up in 2 minutes, we're coming back at 6 o'clock tonight. And I don't mean that to cut anybody off, but that's the reality. Representative Hansen.
Mr. Chair, if the amendment goes on, would the bill then need to go to government ops? I have, you know, you and I have discussed some concerns about the open meeting provision and
Representative Hansen, you weren't here when I moved the bill. It's the referral is to GovOps, assuming this amendment went on. So that's where this bill is headed if it passes today. Any further discussion on the A1? All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, nay.
No.
The amendment adopted. Next, members, I've got an A2. That's Representative Hansen's bill. It allows for small cart barriers down. We actually have a thing in law that says that land that we buy has to be open to public hunting and fishing. We need to be able to put a fence around a fish barrier, and we can't allow people to walk on the concrete inside where the electricity is and get electrocuted. So this is an exclusion. It would not allow some land that actually we own to be open to hunting and fishing because we don't want to let people get electrocuted. Representative Hansen, any further discussion?
I move the bill.
Any discussion to the A2? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Amendment adopted. Representative Hansen has the A3. It deals with neonicotinoids on public land. It's an important amendment that we move forward. It he's going to be discussing it with the DNR. I think it'll be further refined in the legacy committee. Any discussion? It's a good amendment. We're interested in bees, pollinators, and moving that issue forward. Seeing no discussion, all those in favor of the A3 say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Amendment's adopted.
Roll call the bill.
Representative Hansen requests a roll call on the bill. There being no further discussion or amendments to House File 181, I renew my motion. The bill be referred to GovOps. McNamara votes aye.
Clark?
As amended, I'm sorry.
No.
Clark?
No.
Cornish?
Aye.
Dill?
No.
Fabian?
Aye.
Fenton?
Aye.
Fisher?
No.
Green?
Aye.
Hackbart?
Aye.
Hancock?
Aye.
Hansen?
No.
Houseman?
No.
Heintzman?
Aye.
Hornstein?
No.
Johnson?
No.
Neuberger?
Aye.
Purcell?
No.
Poppy?
No.
Rarick?
Aye.
Torkelson?
Aye.
Uglum?
Aye.
There being 12 ayes and 9 nays, the bill is moved on to GovOps. We're adjourned. We're adjourned.